UFC 262 is a deceptively stacked card, and what I mean by that is there's not necessarily a lot of title fights on the card, but there's a bunch of fun fights with big names involved. What's up everybody, it's your boy Trippy, and I am back with another preview video, this time for UFC 262. Let's start with Edson Barboza versus Shane Burgos. I am interested in this fight because both guys had big holes in their game, in my opinion. And in this fight, we're going to see if they've corrected those errors. Because both guys have styles that will exploit those holes if they did not close them properly. Like Edson Barboza, he has beautiful striking, but absolutely crumbles under relentless pressure. And Shane Burgos, as we know, has a chin-first type style. Very gritty, but keeps his hands a little low and has major defensive holes, which was exploited when he fought Josh Emmett. We will have to see, but this was smart matchmaking by the UFC because this is going to be a fun one. But now we move on to Tony Ferguson versus Beneil Dariush, another fun one potentially. But I have the feeling that Beneil Dariush has a lot to gain where Tony Ferguson has a lot to lose potentially. This fits in with the title where I put out with the old, in with the new. This fight gives me those vibes because if all goes well for Beneil Dariush, he will catapult his name to where it ultimately will demand his respect from the lightweight division. Now, Beneil Dariush is no adolescent junior by any means, but he has not established himself in the UFC just yet. But this is his chance because, as you guys know, Tony Ferguson is known by the hardcore fans and is pretty recognized by the casual audience. The match itself is pretty interesting to say the least, but Beneil Dariush is no walk in the park for anyone. He has solid striking with solid grappling, but I wonder, is he going to go the grappling route in this fight? Because on the feet, he is pretty good, but he also has his holes at times. He can be very flat-footed and very hittable, which when fighting Tony Ferguson can be very ill-advised to be a sitting target. Not to mention, Dariush also at times can be comfortable with taking the back foot and circling the cage. On paper, you would say that this is a handy one for the Tony Ferguson we've become to know and love. But that's the thing. We have to see which Tony Ferguson shows up in this fight. Ferguson has also started training with a new coach, which we have to see how that will affect him. His recent fights have not been a good showing, losing both of them dominantly, which is unlike him. But will this new coach correct some of the errors that have been destroying his game recently? Tony Ferguson was a guy who was his own coach for a long time, but now he has accepted guidance from a new coach. We will have to see. I believe that the Justin Gaethje fight, where he received a ton of damage, ultimately dwindled his confidence, leading to what we got out of him in the Charles Oliveira fight. Which leads me to believe, with Beneil Dariush's style and his skill set, we might see a repeat of what happened in the fight with Charles Oliveira. This could either be a really fun one or a really sad one. We will just have to wait and see. So, breaking news. So while I was recording and editing this video, I got a notification on my phone from ESPN saying that Nate Diaz is out of the fight with Leon Edwards for this fight, at least, for this fight card. But he will be returning in June. They're moving the fight to June. And let me just say, I was a little bit bummed out because I was wanting Nate Diaz, or at least I was hoping that Leon Edwards would pull out if somebody was going to pull out. And I was hoping that they would give Diaz a new opponent and possibly scratch this fight altogether. But they're keeping it together and they're moving it to June. So my opinion stays the same on this fight. It hasn't changed a bit. I was a little harsh, I admit, that I was saying that Nate Diaz has little to no chance. I didn't mean that he has zero chance at all. This is MMA. Absolutely anything can happen. Nate Diaz can catch a kick from Leon Edwards, take him to the ground, and Leon tries to get back up and takes his back. Because that can happen. This is MMA, anything can happen. But I would have to say that I think that my prediction stays intact. I just think that we'll see Nate Diaz get outstruck for 5 rounds. But shall this fight goes to the ground, whether Leon Edwards in the later rounds get overwhelmed with the boxing or pressure of Nate Diaz and shoots on Nate Diaz, somehow if this fight gets to the ground, that's when it will start being competitive. But if it plays out on the feet, we could just see Nate Diaz get outpointed for 5 rounds, outstruck, Leon Edwards is going to be utilizing a lot of kicks. Nate Diaz, the Diaz brothers in general, as we know, do pretty poorly against guys who are good kickers. Leon Edwards is an outstanding kicker. I just think that this fight could just be Nate Diaz getting outstruck, getting countered, getting jabbed, and getting tossed around in the clinch and getting sliced up with nasty elbows. But like I said, this is MMA. Anything can happen. Diaz's only major advantage is in the grappling. On the ground, that is. On the ground, that is. I believe Diaz's jiu-jitsu is leaps and bounds beyond Leon Edwards. And that is ultimately where his biggest shot will be, is on the ground. But moving on. So now the main event, Charles Oliveira versus Michael Chandler. A lot of people were a little upset that Michael Chandler got a title shot, and I was one of those people because I thought beating Dan Hooker, a guy who's coming off a loss to Dustin Poirier, wasn't a title eliminator. But when you look deeper into it, you know that Dustin Poirier actually turned down the fight with Charles Oliveira to fight Conor McGregor for a third time, chasing the money fight, essentially. And Charles Oliveira has obviously earned his shot, so Chandler was the only guy that stepped up to the plate. A lot of people were writing off Charles Oliveira, which is weird because the guy has completely turned around his career. Charles Oliveira is longer and rangier, but Michael Chandler may be shorter, but he is a lot faster with his strikes. Charles Oliveira holds the advantage on the ground in terms of pure jiu-jitsu, but I would have to give the wrestling edge to Michael Chandler. Chandler is no slouch on the ground either. He has great offensive grappling, but how is that going to fare against Charles Oliveira, who has possibly the highest level of jiu-jitsu in the division? I don't think that Michael Chandler is going to look to try and take this one to the ground. I really feel like he's going to want to try and keep this one standing. And that's what people give the most advantage to Michael Chandler. But Charles Oliveira has improved his striking. Not to mention he's longer and has very crisp boxing himself, meaning Chandler is going to have to close the distance to land a big bomb that everyone seems to think he will. Chandler likes to push a pace, which could spell trouble for Charles, but he often slows down, but so does Oliveira. Now, the longer it stays on the feet, there will be the big constant danger that Michael Chandler will land that big bomb, putting Charles Oliveira out. But call me crazy, I think that this is Charles Oliveira's time. I just believe that he's finally found his stride, and I believe that he is just on another level now. He has changed as a fighter, and he is ready to make a massive mark on the sport, and that is becoming undisputed UFC lightweight champion. But this is a fight, this is MMA, and you just never know. But we will find out come May 15th. If you enjoyed the video, please make sure you leave a like and subscribe, you guys, and subscribe. We're almost at 125 subscribers, and you know what comes at 125 subscribers, possibly a podcast. But it's been your boy Trippy. I want to know what you guys think. So leave your opinions in the comment section below. Just don't be a dick about it. But it's been your boy Trippy.